Good morning, and thank you so much for joining us and for allowing me to play a role with the AAMA's annual conference. We all look forward to April, and generally, we look forward to being together. But today, we don't have that opportunity, but we still have the opportunity to bring you important programming as you think about what you can do and how you can lead your cities. We are joined today by two dynamic mayors who will talk about building inclusive and resilient cities. And as I think about that, it's really important to understand that you may have a thriving city, but if it isn't thriving for everyone, then we have missed the mark. I'm pleased to first introduce Mayor Deena Ingram, someone who has led East Point, Georgia with resolve, with vision, and with a desire to create an inclusive city. She understands the importance of entrepreneurship. As the daughter of someone who had a construction business. And I have to say it, she's my soror. So welcome, Mayor. I am also pleased to introduce another Georgia mayor, Mayor Hardy Davis from Augusta, Georgia. Mayor Davis is a past president of AAMA. He is also a former state senator, a former state rep, and the mayor who brought the Innovation and Cybersecurity Center to the city of Augusta and has included so many other innovative projects. And so today, we are excited to talk about what an inclusive city looks like. Mayors, we know that there has also always been this notion of the American dream. The fact that people have the opportunity to achieve whatever they dream and the opportunity to pursue that dream without barriers. But we all know that that is not true for everyone. And very often, it is the mayor's role to remove the barriers to create the opportunity to really make sure that that dream is not elusive. And in cities like Gary and East Point and Augusta and other places throughout the country, where our poverty rates sometimes are higher than other cities, it's particularly important to be intentional about how we remove those barriers. And so I want to ask you first, mayors, how have you removed those barriers in the cities of East Point, Georgia, and in Augusta? I'm going to ask Mayor Ingram to go first.
Thank you again, Sora Mayor, for that introduction. And it's a continuous thing. Reality of it is that people kind of go out of experiencing poverty at different times. And we have to create an infrastructure in the city to be able to support and meet people where they are. And I think COVID really helped us accelerate the infrastructure that we have in the city of East Point. The pandemic hit in March of 2020, and by the first week of April, we had pivoted our Parks and Recreation Department to start being a food distribution center, and have distributed over 4 million pounds of food to people in our community. Because what was very clear is that we had to get back to basics. People need food and shelter. And so we have continued to do that weekly to be able to meet the needs of people experiencing, not only experiencing poverty, but what we saw during the pandemic is that it hit so differently that a lot of different people and different income levels were impacted. And so we wanted to make sure that there was an opportunity to to meet a need for our residents and our community with dignity and no judgment. Like, we're just here to help get through this together. I kept assuring them we will get through this together. The other thing that became very clear is financial assistance. We had our community, our unemployment rate in February of 2020 was around 4.7%. And by the end of April 2020, it was 20%. It stayed in double digits until the end of the year. It was like, we topped out in December around 10%. So it went down, but still double digits. And people needed employment. And we needed to figure out how to bridge those gaps. And so we had offered an entrepreneurship, TVN apprenticeship workforce development program the previous year to residents in the city. And we're planning to offer another one, and it kind of got delayed. So we did that, and we were able to train 10 people who and have 100% placement rate on TV or film productions. That, so we're going into season 3 with that. We had started conversations with Construction Ready to be able to provide some construction workforce development services and support. That kind of stalled, but we just kicked that off, and we're doing 2 cohorts for that, right? Because to help people climb out of poverty and help them, assist them, really got to get to building skills, building people, and building the community to help ensure that the infrastructure is there to support them. We've also have been in talks with the security company, but more importantly, we actually completed 2 cohorts of the Kauffman Fast Track entrepreneurship course. And, you know, you mentioned my dad was an entrepreneur. I've kind of been a serial entrepreneur off and on. But the reality of it is that people are finding themselves exploring entrepreneurship or actually following their dreams because of the fact that they need to be able to take care of their families. So the timing was like perfect. Our first cohort happened kind of earlier in 2020. And we had about 10 people sign up, and participation was low. For the one that we launched in January of this year, kind of like start the new year off right with your business plan, we had 15 people participate. So we've graduated 20 people and helped them gain the knowledge to be entrepreneurs, to be able to help continue to support their families. And so I feel like the holistic approach to really addressing what people need, not just looking at poverty and the symptoms of it, but how do we get to root causes and build those skills and capacity and put infrastructure in place to meet the basic needs of residents.
That is really interesting, because what you've proven and what we've seen over and over again is that, you know, as difficult and as challenging as the pandemic was, it also created opportunity. Did you find that in Augusta, Mayor Davis? Mayor Davis, I think you're muted. Yep. Okay.
I'm incredibly pleased to be joining both my good friend, Mayor Ingram, and our friend, Mayor Karen Freeman Wilson. This is an important conversation when we talk about inclusive communities. We've got similar challenges as my colleague mayor in East Point, Georgia, here in Augusta. While we may be Georgia's second largest city, poverty, lack of access to food, where there's insecurity around food, the challenges of healthcare during this global pandemic, they're not unique to cities all across America, and we certainly have faced our own challenges. What we've done are very similar things. With broad partnerships with food distribution, not only with the mayor's office leading several charges to do that, but our Golden Harvest Food Bank has been a staunch advocate and champion. Right at the height of the pandemic, we partnered with World Central Kitchen and Chef Jose Andreas. We were delivering 25,000 meals a week to citizens across our community in an effort to make sure that people had healthy food options and choices, and that they had them for the course of a week, to include our senior citizens. That's important for us, while at the same time understanding, even as Mayor Ingram indicated, at the height of the pandemic, we were tracking at about 3.4, 3.5% unemployment. And then when things really broke loose and the challenges associated with that, not only did you see people who were either underemployed or unemployed totally, but we saw businesses, small businesses, which are the bedrock of our nation's economy and certainly the economy in Georgia and Augusta. And so we established right out of the gate the small business relief plan. We set aside $1 million for that. And then we began to grow and expand that. We look for opportunities from a small business perspective to provide relief with the annual fees that they would have to pay in terms of starting that business and continuing that. Those things have all been significant in terms of trying to stabilize the community, because we can't talk about inclusive communities unless we're also understanding the challenges that businesses have, and they're employing our neighbors, our friends, our coworkers, and even our family members. And so we did some initial things early on to try to bring some sense of stability to the broader community around food, around access to healthcare, around business relief opportunities, while at the same time experiencing the challenges of the state not getting unemployment benefits to individuals when they needed to. And so we went from that to providing rental assistance, making sure that when we put in place eviction moratoriums, that we took a step further and used HCD, or what we consistently call community development block grant dollars, providing rental assistance, making sure people could stay in their homes, and we didn't have a new population of homeless individuals. And so those were very important initial first steps around providing the tools for people to not only have a sense of dignity, knowing that we would work together, we would fight this pandemic together, but we would get through it together as well. And on the other side of that, particularly around this area of building inclusive opportunities, several years ago, I took our local entrepreneur incubator to a Kauffman event with us. We were successful in securing a $499,000 grant that we were able to help build a bench of entrepreneurs who have launched businesses here in the community, some that are tech startups and others that are more traditional businesses. But we've gone beyond that now. And the most important efforts around these things are what we call make startups. You can't talk about entrepreneurship in America, in Georgia, or in any city or state for that matter, without understanding workforce development. And we have to see entrepreneurship as a workforce development issue. And so we've been leaning into that to talk about it from the perspective that this is really a high demand career opportunity or pathway, and going all the way from K through 12, provided some opportunities for folks to be able to do that. Mayor Freeman Wilson, you're muted.
Both of you talked about the importance of supporting entrepreneurs and how the Kauffman Foundation supported your efforts in that regard. I think about our experience in the city of Chicago, and how when PPP started and there weren't a lot of small businesses, especially small Black businesses, that were gaining access to those funds, Mayor Lightfoot asked us to step in, the Chicago Urban League and some other organizations, to provide those micro grants to small businesses. And Mayor Davis, you talked about that as well. Can you talk about the importance of that type of assistance that you all have given in your cities to small businesses, and how they have supported those businesses, how you have supported those businesses?
Good question. I think it's important to recognize, once again, that small businesses really are the heartbeat of our economy, and it doesn't matter where you are. And it was important for us to take those dollars through the First CARES Act and leverage those in a tangible way, because there were businesses, particularly minority-owned businesses, that were not successful in getting the P3 loans. And we did it in a way that they were grants. What I wanted to make sure is that we were not requiring people to pay these things dollars back on the heels of the greatest pandemic in our generation that we've ever faced. And so we did that once again, while at the same time providing substantial relief to the tune, I think, of about $1.2 million in terms of permits, licenses, and fees from an annual standpoint that small businesses have to levy. And so I think it made a huge difference. The challenge going forward is, how do we create that framework for additional dollars and assistance to help through the long term. We know that the hospitality and tourism sector has been the hardest hit across communities. And so even in Augusta, they have seen substantial shifting and change. My convention and visitors bureau, I believe that they're off almost about $1.5 million in terms of revenue that they normally would have gotten, because we didn't have the festivals. We didn't have the Ironman event where you've got 4,700 people coming into our city with an economic impact of $8-9 million. Those things, they make a big difference in terms of how we once again stabilize. So it was important for us to do it. We continue to look for ways. We received a Treasury grant of about $6.5 million that has allowed us to partner with United Way and provide additional renters assistance with now the $1.9 trillion Biden plan that we see from Congress coming into play. We in Augusta stand to receive about $84 million. And we're having some broad conversations about not only what we do in terms of bending that arc towards justice and equity in our community around housing, around homelessness, and workforce development, but more importantly, how do we help small businesses in the community who desperately need it while making a tangible difference to the least of these. And so we're going to continue to make inroads, but the focus again is around building inclusive communities that will have an opportunity to prosper beyond the pandemic.
Mayor Ingram, would you talk about the assistance to small businesses and the importance of it?
So critically important. So when I think of small business, I think of my hairstylist in the city of East Point, right? Who was like, I haven't gotten anything yet. I tried to apply. And so East Point is a little different than Augusta in that our CARES Act funding went through the county.
Sure.
So the county received the CARES Act funding. And unfortunately, that was a very contentious and, eye-opening experience of us actually trying to get money into our communities to be able to support our residents and small businesses. And so once we finally received some money, which was around October, and of course it had to be spent by December, we weren't able as a local community, a local city, to set up our own business support programs. But the county, a number of programs and a number of resources, they allocated millions of dollars just to small businesses. But of course, we kept saying, my businesses in my community are saying they haven't received the support. So we were able to, with the funds that we did receive, set up a utilities assistance program for our residents, and also apply for additional grants to be able to provide rental assistance. But the small business part was kind of handled at the county level. But I can tell you that we have tried to continue to work with the county. There was recently a workshop for small businesses on how to access the funds that are coming, kind of walking them through before it gets there. And so making sure that we're sharing that information of those resources and those workshops that are out to kind of help walk them through the process. And then also, I've reached out to banks who specifically are interested in increasing their small business accounts. So not just businesses in general or, the personal accounts. They specifically have an interest in increasing their small business accounts. And how do we, from a Kauffman perspective, right, is knowledge, capital, and network.
That's it.
So the fast track is the knowledge. The network, we have monthly opportunities for that. We have an annual symposium, but the capital is key. And how do we make sure that we're building that ecosystem in our community? So that's what we're doing as we kind of continue to go through this. And, CDFI big banks are very open to working with communities like ours. And so we're exploring those avenues.
Go ahead, Mayor Davis.
Yeah, let me mention something. Mayor Ingram mentioned the fact that they did not get direct funding. None of us received direct funding unless we were a city or a county of 500,000 plus people in that first wave of CARES Act funding. And I think that's the power of mayors with this most recent round of funding us lending our voices to this broader conversation so that there's not only direct funding to cities and counties, regardless of population, but we also don't have to wait on the state to try to decide if they want to distribute those dollars. You know, I look back at how much more we could have done to help communities of interest around businesses and even individuals. But here in Georgia, because the money came to the state, we only received 10 million of the 25 million we were supposed to receive because the governor decided to hold on those dollars. And that's important in this broader discussion, because now with this new tranche of money that's coming in, we're going to get it directly. We're going to, because we, again, as mayors, as leaders, know best what's going on in our cities, and we're going to be able to make tremendous impact around these significant social issues, these health issues, these issues of economic opportunity and equity, because we're getting direct funding.
And you raised that, and that is one of the points relative to the importance of organizations like the AAMA. But also when Mayor Ingram talked about the importance of information and networking, that is really how the Kauffman Foundation can help cities to help their businesses. I mean, you know, everybody wants a check. Let's be clear about it. You can always do what you want to do with that. But what I've learned, and certainly what I've learned, what I learned during my days as a mayor and what I continue to learn with the Chicago Urban League, is that the information that you can provide to businesses for the business owners can be priceless. And that's the value we think of Kauffman's new business plan, the America's new business plan, as well as the Startups Up Coalition. And so we would just encourage those mayors who are listening, who may or may not be a part of the Kauffman Initiative, to check out the Startups Up Coalition, because it has the ability to really provide that information and that network to your cities. But let's talk about that technical assistance. How do you get that out to your businesses? How do you make that available? And how do you do it, particularly in the midst of a pandemic?
You know, that's a great question, particularly in terms of how do you do it in the pandemic. I think one of the things that we've all learned is that there are different ways to conduct business in today's economy. And instead of necessarily looking at it from the perspective of, Zoom meetings are a bad thing, the reality of it is I can have a meeting with you right now in real time across the globe without having to get on a plane or anything. And so we've got to leverage these technologies that allow us to be not only portable, but present at the same time. And so many small businesses didn't have those capabilities. But being able to provide them with just insight on low to no cost solutions. You know, most everybody's got a smartphone. They've got some type of tablet or device that you can conduct business in ways across the globe, not just the state or your city, but the nation. And so we've led some initiatives around that, sharing some very basic things. We've got our Greater Augusta Black Chamber of Commerce that's gotten involved in having a series of webinars pushing this type of information out as well. At the same time, our group, the Clubhouse here in Augusta, that was the recipient of the Kauffman grant, they've done a substantial job in terms of working with Kauffman and leveraging their assets here at the Georgia Cyber Innovation and Training Center, of where they're housed at right now, to help leverage getting people into that stream of one, information and knowledge and networking, and being able to do that in circles that they normally would not have been a part of. And I applaud my local folks, Eric Parker and Grace Belangia, because they've been focused around this conversation that in order to accelerate economic recovery and address the underlying public health challenges that we're experiencing even now, but more importantly, workforce and entrepreneurship issues of inequity. That is the only way we're going to be able to address generational poverty and its role, not just from a health standpoint, but just from an access standpoint. Even when it comes to, we talked about the Paycheck Protection Program and people of color not being able to access that. Often it's because I didn't know, I didn't have the relationships, I didn't have the access. And so they've done a great job of helping to build that network, that framework around workforce innovation, entrepreneurship, and the strategies of how even the most basic business could have those access points.
Yeah, I would also add, like, so again, the other, I guess, bright side or the efficiencies learned during COVID was people were looking more at technology sources. So emails and, you know, communicating in a technology way or, in, you know, sending those things. And so we were able to increase the people that we were reaching. So we were always sending like business newsletters, sending information out. But when everybody was forced to kind of this technology world, right, I believe we were able to connect with and reach more people through those emails, through those monthly connection opportunities. We also have in our city two businesses that specifically focus around building entrepreneurs in Black wealth. So the Legacy Center is modeled after Black Wall Street, right? And trying to bring that back into our communities. And so providing a number of opportunities for people to connect and network, but also building capacity around entrepreneurship skills. The Vault at East Point is another business focused on wealth, real estate, health, and in the arts. And so this entrepreneurial piece and really supporting Black businesses and bringing people who, you know, are connected to their brands and to their initiatives into the city or into knowing about the resources available at East Point, but also having resources on our website. I feel like the fact that they're there, more people have been able to actually access it. So when you click on the links, it talks about the Small Business Administration, right? It talks about the Georgia Department of Revenue. How do you really connect people to the existing resources that are in place? And we also have a small business incentive program in the city of East Point to provide incentives for like facade improvement, initial business license, a tax credit for we own our own utilities, right? So water, electric, utility rate reduction. So things to help people get from garage to storefront. So being able to have that information in place or have those initiatives in place for such a time as this, and I feel like people have access them more because people have really had to, you know, be the mayors, governors, and presidents of their own household, right? And really figure out how to lead their families through this difficult time. And we've just wanted to be a partner with it and make it easier, right? We will get through this together is what I continue to say. And that is by meeting the needs and really working collaboratively together.
You know, one of the things that our preliminary research at Kauffman has shown is that there was an increase in businesses in terms of startups during the pandemic. Did you find that to be the case? And, you know, did you find it to be more traditional or in other sectors that had not necessarily been in your communities before? What was your experience, Mayor Davis?
Well, in Augusta, we've seen certainly more traditional startups, but we also have seen business expansion where you've got businesses that made a decision that even in the midst of the pandemic, they were going to expand into other parts of the community. We're very fortunate to see that happening while at the same time to have new businesses, new startups, new entrepreneurs in the economy making a difference, whether it was food service, whether it was cleaning services, you know, some of your more essential things that you have to have. You had new people entering into that space saying, we're going to provide a service. Even now, just within the last week, you know, we've had news reports and features of businesses that are in the hospitality industry that have said, we're going to make a go at it. And I'm really excited about that because people believe in this community. They believe in the people in the community, and they're willing to take those risks while at the same time knowing that they've got a government that's doing everything we can to support and bolster those efforts. And I think that's one of the things the pandemic has shown as well, that people's perception, people's experience with the access points in local government have fundamentally changed. When you talk about, you know, eviction moratoriums being extended for significant periods of time, when you talk about water moratoriums and you're not letting people water get cut off because you care about people, and then you're, you know, trying to meet the need around food security by providing meals. Those things, they matter. They get a chance to see people in government and their elected leaders differently, as opposed to, quote, someone who's on this high perch, you know, looking for an opportunity to do things that may not always be in their best interest. So I think that's what's important as we move forward, while at the same time, knowing that we're not done yet. We've got more work to do to create that inclusive community, to include people who have been left behind when it comes to being able to start up a business. And then those that are looking for career opportunities, changes. You know, how do we do that? Here in Augusta, we've created a pathway for students in grades 3 through 12. They can become the cyber patriots of the nation right here, starting in grades 3 through 12, because of the infrastructure we have in place, where historically, individuals Black and brown don't always go into those careers. But they're high paying, long-term opportunities, whether it's the military or private sector. And so I think it's having the nexus between good public policy, good community relations, and finding out how to bridge those gaps to include layering on workforce development and education in a way that allows individuals, to include our youth, to see themselves in a way that they may not have seen themselves before. I oftentimes say this, a man or a woman cannot be what he or she cannot see. So we've got to create something for young people to be able to see that that inspires them, that encourages them. You know, I'm not 6'4". I'm not dunking anymore. And there's not a single thing wrong with that. And I applaud all of my athletes. I can play with the best of them, but I also understand my grace gift. You know, instead of playing me a dribble to shoot, you can pay me to talk, or you can pay me to code. Those are things that allow us to inspire, to engage, but create that inclusive community, that inclusive economy of where generationally you're able to transform your family's trajectory.
You know, that is an excellent point, Mayor Davis. What about in East Point, Mayor? What have you seen in terms of business startups?
So definitely have seen an increase in, as I mentioned, in through the Kauffman Fast Track program, that was 20 new entrepreneurs, right, that were trained with the knowledge to be able to be successful in their business and hopefully, you know, shorten that 3 to 5 year loss or at least be planning for it as it takes to commit to the business. But the knowledge part is really, really critical. And so, you know, I think Mayor Davis mentioned the public policy piece. So the East Point City Council adopted a resolution several years ago from a city perspective saying we are committed to building a full continuum of support for small business and entrepreneurs in our city. And I think that is critically important when the government says this is important to us and that this is the work that we're going to commit to doing. And I'm a person that believes in like quality, not quantity. So when I attended the Kauffman Foundation conference and learned about Fast Track, and I was like, okay, so this is my go-to for entrepreneurialism, for the ecosystem building, right? Like knowledge. I don't believe we need 10 different programs because we all can't speak the same language, right? Sure. So, you know, having that, and we did it virtually, but what happened at the graduate, we had a graduation ceremony, it was done virtually, but at the end, we had a food truck, which was on, you know, the business of one of the participants come to the vault at East Point location, and people were able to come and get their meals and kind of, you know, socialize with CDC, following the guidelines, right? But really putting that support in action and really not just saying we want to support, but putting things in place and showing up and being present to be able to help, you know that we are, when we say we're committed, we really are. And again, I think now more than ever, especially for communities of color, we really have to figure out how to resource map, how to connect these dots, how to have the knowledge, the network and capital for entrepreneurialism, because our communities were disproportionately impacted more than others, right? When you talk about people who are unemployed and people who, you know, find themselves trying to figure out how they're gonna make ends meet, being an entrepreneur is actually a way to, you know, look at the glasses half full and be like, well, I don't have a job to go to, but I can create one for myself, right? I can create this business that will not only help take care of me and my family, but small businesses, as Mayor Davis said, are the lifeline of our communities. You know, small businesses stay. Big chain retail, if they go, it's a big building that's vacant, right? But the small businesses, they stay. They're really a part of the community and provide jobs. And so, you know, that's kind of how we've been looking at it, as a real critical piece, economic development, and really the sustainability of our city, because we know when small businesses succeed, communities in our city succeed, because we stay partnered and committed to work.
We are so grateful for both of your insights and for you sharing your success in East Point, in Augusta. You know, I'll have to tell you that Mayor Patterson Howard mentioned the technical assistance and education that comes from the Kauffman Foundation in our chat. And I thank you, Mayor, for that. That's one of my former drug court colleagues. But I also want us to understand, and Mayor Ingram, you made an incredible point when you talked about the larger businesses. And, you know, I get it. I've done it as mayor, as someone who supports a mayor now. You want that big company. You want that, you know, 1,000, 2,000 job opportunity. But we know that the majority of people in our communities are employed by small businesses. And so our opportunity to support those businesses, to support those startups, and to do it with incredible partners like the Kauffman Foundation is just priceless. I would encourage folks to go and take a look at the Kauffman website to see America's New Business Plan, which is a bipartisan platform for helping and supporting businesses in your community. And then I would also invite cities and organizations, because it's not just limited to cities, to join us at startusupnow.org to read the plan and then sign up for updates for the work. And just want to congratulate you both for the success in your cities and for leading with just distinction during one of the most challenging times in our country. That was one of my biggest joys from the sidelines, to see my friends on CNN, to see you all leading in your respective communities, and to do it with a sense of calm, not panic, because you all knew you needed to reassure your residents, and that's just what you did. And so thanks for joining us out in cyberspace. And thank you for the opportunity to build inclusive and prosperous communities, because we know that when every resident has an opportunity to win, our cities have an opportunity to win.